that some idea that somehow there's a kind of corporate liberal structure which incorporates unionism into the establishment, or into a kind of structure, or even that unions are the labor lieutenants of capital. Even that idea, union leaders, the labor lieutenants of capital, that idea has certainly faded. I mean, just the headlines have instructed us on that. That view is fading in part because it never really described corporate leadership in the 1950s, or 40s or 50s, who remained hostile to all varieties of unionism, not just communist-led unionism, in part because of a growing appreciation for garden variety trade unionism as a boon and a backstop to liberal democratic culture. Ordinary, old-fashioned, anti-communist trade unionism was essential, was integral to that kind of New Deal or post-New Deal world. As Jack Metzger and Josh Freeman and Timothy Minchin, these are recent labor historians, and many others have come to argue, the 40s and 50s were not an era of repression and stratification, but one, in a sense, of liberation for millions of blue-collar workers who used the new prosperity and the prosaic grievance procedures and incremental increases in wages of that era to win a sense of social citizenship for the first time in their lives. I mean, this is the generation that was the immigrant generation, the second generation immigrants of the 30s, and they are now becoming a sense of full citizenship. This is not a neoconservative tribute to the placid 50s. I'm not trying to make that. But I think a liberal, less liberal understanding of what we have won and what we have lost during the last half century. Let me give you an example of the historiographical distortion that took place in say, thinking about the Taft-Hartley Law, for example. Many features of the Taft-Hartley Law. The one that is most known is, of course, the exclusion of the communists, or those who were thought to be communists. The trade union leaders had to sign an affidavit asserting that they were not members of the Communist Party. And that, of course, wreaks terrific havoc amongst the left trade unions and splits the union movement. And Ellen has written eloquently on this. And it was a tragedy. It was terrible. It was a form of repression. No denying that whatsoever. Not trying to gainsay that. There was another, but other features of Taft-Hartley turned out to be far more damaging to the trade union movement. One of which I dare say most of you probably haven't heard of, was the prohibition on foreman unionism, supervisory unionism, which there had been a huge movement for that. The Supreme Court had actually validated it, and then the law just eliminated it. What that meant was that it really, the expansion of trade unionism into the blue-collar, retail, service sector, private service sector, was absolutely blocked. In fact, the reason we have unionism in the public sector is that in the public sector, supervisors and foremen can be part of the union, whereas the private, under Taft-Hartley, they can't. It turns out that the natural leaders of many, many kinds of workplaces and unions, therefore, are in fact the lower level supervisors. They're the natural leadership. These people have been just cut off of the net, as it were. And in the, if you've been following any of the issues in labor law recently, you know the recent NLRB decision expanding the definition of a supervisor, making most nurses, in fact, supervisors, is a way of curbing unionism. Now, this issue, well, yeah, the industrial relations wonks studied this, but historians never were concerned about it. But this is a form of denial of political rights, which I think was turned in the long run was in fact more consequential than the purge of the communists. I'm being a little provocative here. Ellen will come back, I'm sure, and get me on this. And certainly, when we put the ideological and industrial regime that's put in place by Walmart next to that deployed by Alice Chalmers and the Ford Motor Company, both sites of McCarthyite purges, when we compare Walmart And, you know, Ford, even after Ford had gotten rid of the communists, well, you know, you can make your judgment as to which one has the more genuine freedom and more genuine possibility for working class organization.